الله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله. All praises be to God, the cherisher, the sustainer of this universe. And may his peace and blessings be upon his noble prophets, Abraham and Noah and Jesus, son of Mary, and Moses and Muhammad. And may his peace and blessings be upon all the prophets and their followers. Dear respected brothers and sisters, let me welcome you with the greeting of Islam, which is the greeting of peace. Peace be upon you. And I would like to thank you for coming today. And I would like to thank the Leeds Grand Mosque for inviting me for the second time. Many of them couldn't realize that I am Father Solomon today because I lost 10 pounds. They saw me last year, but I lost 10 pounds. I found 6 of them back, but anyway. Let me reintroduce myself to you. My name is Fadl Solomon. Fadl Solomon. I'm the director of Bridges Foundation. Here, this logo on my shirt is not actually the logo of the petrol station that I work for. This is actually Bridges Foundation, which is an international organization that specializes in introducing Islam to non-Muslims and in bridging the gap between people from different backgrounds based on educating people about each other. And this is actually important because I believe that ignorance is our enemy. And the problem is that many people don't want to learn about something different because they think that ignorance is an insult, while it's not. Ignorance is lack of information, not lack of intelligence. I am the most ignorant, probably, in this mosque about Hinduism. And I have no problem seeking knowledge about it. Many people think that Muslims in their mosques have hijacking classes, how to make a bomb class. So it's very important that people come to the mosque and see how peaceful Muslims are. Today's presentation is called The Fog is Lifting, which is actually the same one that I did in Denmark during the cartoon crisis about 10 years ago, if you remember. So I'm going to give it for the second time today to you. It's called The Fog is Lifting, which actually turned into, it became now 3 documentaries about Islam. The first one is in 31 languages now. When we talk about Islam, we are not talking about just a religion. What's a religion? A religion is a communication channel between people and their creator. It's a system that shows us how to worship and who to worship. Islam is much more than just how to worship and who to worship. It's a whole system that people enact in their houses, in their businesses, and so on. Even when it comes to dealings with others, banking, and it's a whole way of life, actually. Muslims are 1.6 billion people in this world, and that's an enough reason for non-Muslims to know about Islam. Because if I ask anyone about the Chinese, and he says, yeah, the Chinese are people who have blonde hair, or they live in Africa, this will not sound good. Why? Because the Chinese are a very big group of people. How come anyone in this world doesn't know some features about the Chinese? How come someone in this world with us doesn't know that the Chinese live in Asia, for example? Because 20% of the population of this world are Chinese. Same thing, Muslims are 20% of the population of this world. That's an enough reason for you to know about Islam. 1 out of every 5 people who walks the earth today is a Muslim. And they're not going to finish. Trump is not going to finish Muslims, by the way. So they are your colleagues. They are your neighbors. Yes, you are welcome to come here today and tomorrow and anytime you want. So today's presentation is simply this. M plus 6 plus 5 equals, M plus 6 plus 5 equals what? Equals Islam. That's today's presentation. M, the meaning of the word Islam. So today we will learn together what is the meaning of the word Islam. The 6 main beliefs that are obligatory for every Muslim to believe in order to be a Muslim. And the five main deeds that are also obligatory of every Muslim, for every Muslim to do in order to become Muslim. And then we can talk maybe about, if we have time, about the status of women in Islam, if we have time. First, with the meaning of the word Islam. Islam is the only religion which is not called after someone, or after a group of people, or after a geographic region. For example, Hinduism is called after India. Judaism after Judas, the tribe of Judas, a group of people. Christianity after Jesus Christ, peace be upon him. Islam after who? We're not called after someone called Salim or something. You know that there is someone that we revere so much and we love so much called Muhammad, but Muslims find it very offensive when they are called Muhammadans, even though they love him so much. Why is it offensive for Muslims to be called Muhammadans? Because they are not Muhammadans, they are Muslims like him and like other prophets. Islam is a concept, is a word in Arabic that comes from a three-letter root. Arabic words come from three-letter roots. Some of them come from a four-letter root, but most of them come from a three-letter root. The word Islam comes from Salama, those three letters. And surprisingly, from the same three letters, you can have three different terms in Arabic that have three different meanings. The first one is submission. Istislam. The second one is purity. Salama. And the third one is peace. Salam. So those are three words with three different meanings that come from the same root of the word Islam. Surprisingly, the word Islam idiomatically is a combination of those three words. The word Islam idiomatically means that if someone submits to Almighty God and worships Him purely, without any association with Him, he or she should live in peace and harmony in this life and in the hereafter. Submission, purity, and peace. Therefore, the word Muslim doesn't mean a follower of Prophet Muhammad. Literally, it means someone who submits to God and worships God alone without any association with God. Before I move to the next part, which is the six main beliefs, there are some relevant issues that I need to speak to you about. The first one is, and by the way, these are relevant issues that I need to address with you, and I'm not expecting you to agree with them all, but it's a matter of perspective. First, Muslims believe that every human being is born ready to submit to God. We don't believe that we were born with an original sin. We were born with an original goodness. Everyone was born ready to submit to God. No one will say on the day of judgment, God, you cannot punish me because you are the one who created me Arab. So I was bad by nature. Or Chinese. So I was bad by nature. Or white. So I was bad by nature. No one will say that. Every single person in this world, male or female, white or black or Arab or Indian or Chinese, was born clean and pure by nature with an original goodness. Second, Muslims believe that human beings have free choice. God Almighty showed us the right path and the wrong path, and then He left us to choose freely without any influence on our choices. So every one of us is fully responsible for his actions. Muslims believe that there should be no compulsion in religion. That's actually a verse in the Quran, chapter number 2, verse number 256. It says, let there be no compulsion in religion. Because some people think that Islam has been spread by the sword. Islam cannot be spread by force. If someone compels someone else to become Muslim, for example, if I bring one of the non-Muslims and tell him to sit here, and someone puts a gun in his head and tells him, write down, I am a Muslim. Put down your passport number and your bank signature. Still, he's not a Muslim. Why? Because he was compelled. You know why this verse descended on Prophet Muhammad? It was revealed from on high. Why? Because there was, before Islam, there was, you know, actually Arabs at that time were so ignorant and they hated to have newborn baby girls. So many of them used to vow, God, if you give me a boy, not a girl, I will judaize him. Because of that, there was a generation of Jewish young people whom their parents were idolaters. Because they were judaized, because they were born males. What happened is, after some of those parents became Muslim, they started to put pressure on the Jewish youth to convert them by force from Judaism to Islam. God revealed to Prophet Muhammad, let there be no compulsion in religion. Leave them alone. Why force anyone to become Muslim? So this verse was revealed from above seven heavens to defend Jewish youth. Muslims believe that people are born without any inherited sin. We believe that if someone sins or commits any crime, he or she should come on the day of judgment carrying their own sins on their own shoulders, not on the shoulders of their sons or their grandsons or their grandsons. Even though we believe that we are from Adam and Adam's from earth, and we believe that Adam sinned, it's true, but he repented and God accepted his repentance. So actually the Islamic view of the sin of Adam is that people can sin and repent. It's not the end of the world. This is one of the main also issues about this sin of man. Second, we believe that Adam and Eve sinned, and then God revealed to them the way to repent. And it was not by saying, I seek forgiveness of God 10,000 times. No. It was by starting to say, we indeed have wronged ourselves. And if you forgive us not, we will definitely be losers. Which means, they have to start by self-criticism. And this is exactly what we need. Many of us are just criticizing everyone. And they criticize their spouses, their government, their neighbors. When was the last time you criticized yourself? So the first lesson we learn from the story of Adam is self-criticism. You have to be self-critique. This doesn't mean that we don't have an original sin. We know that there is an original sin, but it's not inherited. And it's not the sin of Adam. When I say original sin, it means the very first sin ever committed in history. That's not the sin of Adam. It is the sin of the devil. When God created Adam, he announced to all the creation that I now am going to assign a boss on earth. And this boss, you should all help him to achieve his task. And his task will mainly be to worship God and to develop the earth. So all of you should bow down in submission to this boss, the human being. Everyone did, except one, Satan. And God blamed him in the Quran, telling him, why didn't you prostrate yourself to the one that I created as I commanded you? He said, because I am better than him. I am better than him. You created me from fire and you created him from clay. I am white and he's black. I am European and he's Arab. I am Arab and he's Indian. So the very first sin, the original sin, according to Islamic teachings, is not an apple that was eaten from a tree. It was racism. God then told him, get out from paradise. You cannot act as a racist here. So according to Islam, the original sin is racism. Racists have no place in paradise. Period. As Muslims, we believe that there should be no supremacy based on color, race, or sex. One of the teachings of Prophet Muhammad is, all people in the sight of God are as equal as the teeth of a comb. He also said there is no privilege for an Arab on an Arab, nor for a white on a black, except according to the level of righteousness. So it's about righteousness, not being male, not being white, not being black, not being Arab, not being rich. It's about if you are more righteous, you are more honored in the sight of God. Like that, we finish the relevant issues, and I don't know if you differ with me on that or not, but let's move to the six beliefs. To be a Muslim, I have to believe in six main beliefs. I have to believe in the existence of God. Allah. Is he a different God from the one that Jews and Christians worship? We will come to this in details. I have to believe in the existence of angels. And I have to believe in all the scriptures, all the books of God. And I have to believe in all the messengers of God. And I have to believe in the day of resurrection. And I finally have to believe in the divine destiny. Let's take one by one and go into it in details. To believe in God, Allah. The word Allah is an Arabic word that means the one true God. So I'm Egyptian. We have about 4 or 5 million Christian Egyptians. All of them worship Allah. One of my Christian friends is called Majdi Abdullah. Abdullah, he's Christian, and his father is Christian. It's called Abdullah. You know where you can find the word Allah? In the Bible that you find on in the drawer of any hotel room. It is printed by Gideons. It's an organization that prints Bibles and distributes them to all hotel rooms. If you open this Bible, at the last page, it tells you, we also printed this Bible in 32 languages. Among them is Arabic. And the word Allah is there. That shows the very first verse of the Bible. Let me show you here. If you open the very first page of any Arabic Bible, this word, At-Takwin, means Genesis. And the word Allah, you find it in the first paragraph 5 times. In the whole page, 17 times. All through the Old Testament and the New Testament, thousands of times. So when Muslims say, La ilaha illallah, there is no God except Allah, this shouldn't offend you. This unites us. But Muslims believe that Allah is unique, that there is nothing like unto him. Anything that your mind can imagine, he is beyond. He is the creator of man. He is the creator of plants. He is the creator of animals. He doesn't look like any man. He doesn't look like any plant. He doesn't look like any animal. Anything that your mind can imagine, he is beyond. He is unique. He has no partners. He is alone the creator of this universe, and he is the sustainer of everything that exists. He sustains us now by oxygen. He sustains us during the coffee breaks. He sustains at the same time billions of fish in the water and in the streams. He sustains at the same time billions of birds in the sky. I know that today, not everyone who comes to these events is a Christian or a Jew or a Muslim or even, there are people of no faith. People of no faith were sent some messages in the Quran. God told them and us, if you are looking for me, look around you. You will not see me, but you will see the signs of my existence. God says in the Quran, in the creation of the heavens and the earth, and in the alternation of the night and the day, there are signs for people of understanding. Which means look around you. You will not see me, but you will see the signs of my existence. This cannot move from here to there without someone moving it. What about all these creatures, planets,
with all the synchronization and the numerations and the beauty. How can this be without a creator?
God also said, don't only look around you, look in yourself. Because actually, you can see me if you look in yourself. God said, we will show them our signs in the distant regions and in themselves, so that they may realize that this is the truth. Which means you yourself is full of miracles. Take one miracle. The eye is a miracle. How does the eye see? The light reflects on the object and then it reflects on my eye retina, where it is transferred into pulses to a place in the brain called the center of vision. This place in the brain, the center of vision, is probably the darkest part of your body because it never saw the light. In the back of your skull, except if you had a brain operation and they opened the skull once, so it saw the light. Otherwise, it never saw the light. In this part of the body, the darkest part of your body, you see all those beautiful, bright, colorful images, three-dimensional. You know how many thousands of engineers today in China, in TV factories, are trying to come up with an image as sharp, clear, and bright as the one that your eye can see, and still they can't? If someone said, TVs that we have at home just came by chance, atoms accumulated, and they came by chance, no one would believe it. But some people believe that this eye and the vision system came by chance. Same applies on your kidney, on your liver, on everything. And what I'm saying is not new. It's not only what Muslims have said. It's also what Aristotle have said, what Socrates have said, what Plato have said, and what also the philosophers and thinkers of the Enlightenment era have said, like Pascal, Spinoza, and René Descartes. I always like to quote René Descartes, by the way. Because he said, I doubt that there is God. But since I doubt, then therefore I think. And since I think, then therefore I exist. And he said, je pense donc j'existe. And since I exist, then therefore someone has created me. And since I did not create myself, then this someone else who have created me is God. And he reached the fact that there is God through doubting God. This is in a verse in the Quran. Exactly. Exactly what he said. And it says, were they created without a creator? Or were they their own creators? To be a Muslim, one has to believe that there are angels. They are created from light. We don't see them. They do not have free will, which means it doesn't mean that and it doesn't any oppression for them, but they just do what they are told. So they don't have free choice like us. So they will not be held accountable. Each angel is assigned to do a specific task, like carry the messages of God to the messengers of God. Archangel Gabriel was to carry the messages of God to the messengers of God, and to some of them to record our deeds. To be a Muslim, one has to believe in all the books of God. To be a Muslim, I have to believe in the Quran that was sent to Prophet Muhammad. And I have to believe in the Torah that was sent to Prophet Moses. And I have to believe in the gospel that was sent to Prophet Jesus, son of Mary. And I have to believe in the Psalms of David. And I have to believe in the scrolls of Abraham. But what is the Quran? I know that maybe, probably most of you are from a Christian or a Jewish background. So you have the Old Testament and the New Testament, right? The Quran is the last testament. It is the last revelation of God. It is the principal source of every Muslim's faith and practice. And it deals with all subjects that concern human beings, including wisdom, doctrine, worship, and law. And the Quran has two main basic themes. The first one is the relationship between God and His creation, and the second one is the relationship between people, one and another of them. And it provides guidelines for a just society, proper human conduct, and equitable economic principles. Let me show you a sample from the Quran. This is a very important sample, because every Muslim has to read this sample at least 17 times every day during his or her five prayers. Because Muslims pray five times, and they have 17 circuits of prayers during those five times. In every circuit of prayer, when we stand up, we have to read this sample of the Quran. It is the opening chapter, and it's called Al-Fatiha. It says, in the name of God, the compassionate, the merciful, all praise be to Allah, the Lord of the worlds, the compassionate, the merciful, King of the Day of Judgment. You alone we worship, and to you alone we turn for help. Guide us to the straight path, the path of those whom you have favored, not of those who have gone astray, not of those who have incurred your anger. Amen. The second sample is a very dear sample to my heart, because it's an answer to a question that I used to have in my mind for so many years. For so many years, I used to ask myself, why did God create us from different backgrounds? And people are fighting each other. Men and women, those who are married will understand. Whites and blacks, for centuries, problems between whites and blacks. Arabs, problems today. Koreans may be doing problems tomorrow. Wasn't it a better idea that God could have created us all from one background, instead of fighting with each other? Like all of us, men, Italian, eating pizza, and that's it. Or we could have been all Chinese, speaking Chinese and eating Chinese, which could have been good for me, by the way. But because in the Quran you can find an answer to any question about the creation, I found the answer to my question. God said in the Quran, O mankind. He's not saying, O Muslims. He's speaking to each and everyone in this room. O mankind, we created you from male and female and made you into nations with an S, and tribes with an S, that you may know each other. Surely the most honored of you in the sight of Allah is males? No. Females? No. Whites? No. Blacks? No. Arabs? No. Who is the most righteous of you? It doesn't matter if you're male or female, white or black or Arab or Indian. It doesn't matter. Surely the most honored of you is the most righteous of you, which actually means that Muslims believe that God did not choose any race to be the chosen people. God did not choose the Arabs to be the chosen people. God did not choose the Chinese to be the chosen people. God did not choose the Jews to be the chosen people. No one. If you're more righteous individually, you are more honored than anyone else. You're closer to God than anyone else. Let me show you what the Quran said about the other books. How do you think the Quran spoke about the Torah that was given to Moses? God says, surely we sent down the Torah to Moses. Therein was guidance and light by which the prophets who submitted themselves to Allah's will judged the Jews. So the Torah of the Jews is mentioned in the Quran as a source of guidance and light. By the way, Muslims believe that the Torah is nearly the greatest book of God after the Quran, but it is one of the greatest books of God. And also, the gospel was mentioned. How do you think the gospel of Jesus was mentioned? God says in chapter number 5, verse number 46, we sent Jesus, son of Mary, confirming the Torah that had come before him, and we gave him the gospel in which was guidance and light, and confirmation of the Torah that had come before it, a guidance and an admonition to the pious. So the gospel of Jesus was also mentioned in the Quran as a source of guidance and light. I have to be clear with you. When we say we believe in all the books, I mean the original books. If someone tells you, let me give you an English Quran,
Tell him, excuse me, I attended the focus lifting in Leeds Grand Mosque, and I know that there is nothing as the so-called English Quran. The Quran is only the Arabic one. Say an English translation of the Quran. As long as there is a human contribution, for example, by translation, which is needed. We need people to translate the Quran to all languages. But these translations are not purely divine, because there's a human contribution. So the Quran is a book that has been kept safe in its original language, the Arabic language. Otherwise, there are translations. Translations are good, needed, but they are not the original book. And same applies on other books. We believe in the original books that have been sent, in the original text, to the messenger of God. The Quran is actually not a book of science. But in the Quran, there is amazing things. And actually, Islam is a religion that respects science so much. Religion and science are associates in Islam. Actually, one of the prayers that God taught us in the Quran is to say, and say, oh my Lord, increase me in knowledge. There is nothing else that we were told to ask increase of except knowledge. There is no prayer like, oh my Lord, increase me in wealth. No. Oh my Lord, increase me in health. No. Only knowledge. We were told to ask increase of all the time. We have to learn. Actually, Saladin, if you heard about him, he's the Muslim king who conquered the Crusaders and returned back Jerusalem to the Muslim world. His closest advisor was a Jewish rabbi, the most famous Jewish rabbi in the Jewish history, Maimonides. He was a Jew, and he was a scientist. Being Jewish, Christian, or Muslim, that's personal, between one and God. But being scientist, that's not personal. The society has to benefit from it. I believe that if Galileo Galilei was to live in a Muslim country at that time, he could have never ended up in jail. Many Muslim scientists had a big impact on the world. Among them is Jaber ibn Hayyan, or in Latin, Geber. He is known as the father of chemistry. He invented about 25 tools that are still maybe used sometimes in laboratories. Al-Khwarizmi, known in Latin as algorithm. He's the one, may Allah forgive him, who invented algebra. And he was very instrumental in the use of algorithms, and which are named after him, and trigonometry and calculus. He's the one who invented the zero. That's why we have Apple today, because of algorithm. You know who was the first man to have an apple? Adam. That's a joke, by the way, you can laugh. Ibn Sina. Ibn Sina, known in Latin as Avicenna. For philosophers, he is called the number two teacher after Aristotle. But he was also very instrumental, actually, very important in medicine. He has two books of medicine that were actually the authority on medicine for 500 years. Today, everyone to become a doctor, he has to study Oxford. But for 500 years, it's the two books of Avicenna. One of them is called the Canon of Medicine, and the other one is called the Book of Healing. Someone once stopped me and told me, you guys are always violent, even your scientists. He called his book the Canon of Medicine. But that's a canon with one N, not double N. That's not the weapon. Canon means al-qanun in Arabic, the law of medicine. At that time, people were taking from the Arabic language, putting in their language, because the Arabic language was the language of science. If anyone wanted to learn science, he has to go and learn Arabic for a year or two first. Now, the language of science is English. That's why you find Arabs today saying television, radio, even when they talk in Arabic. Why? Because the language of science became English now for centuries. The language of science was the Arabic language. Al-Zahrawi, known in Latin as Al-Bukassis, he is also known as the father of modern surgery. He invented 200 tools of surgery that many of them are still in use. Many scientific discoveries are used today for a better understanding of some verses of the Quran, which actually many Muslims like to call it the scientific miracles of the Quran. But it's really amazing when you find these things in the Quran. For example, God said in the Quran 14 centuries ago, He sent down, "It is He who created the night and the day and the sun and the moon. They swim along, each in an orbit." Who was able to know at that time that every planet, every star has its own orbit? He also said about mountains, "Have we not made the earth as a wide expanse and the mountains as pegs?" You know the pegs that are used to fix the tent? Look at them. See how similar the pegs are to the mountains? They don't look similar at all, I know. But how do we use the pegs to fix the tents? We dig it all under the ground and we only leave the top of it above the ground so that we can fix the rope of the tent in it, right? That's exactly what Dr. George Airy discovered in this country about 100 years ago, saying that mountains are merely the tops of great masses of rocks floating in a denser substratum like icebergs float in water. So actually what you see as a mountain is not the mountain, it's the top part of the mountain only. Mount Everest is 8 kilometers above the ground and 64 kilometers under the ground. Who could have known this 14 centuries ago? Neither Prophet Muhammad nor any of his companions were geologists. God said in the Quran, well, that's enough of the scientific miracles. There is something that actually was amazing, and I don't know, but it's not in the presentation, where God spoke about His ability to return us back to life after resurrection, perfectly. So He said, yes, we are able to fashion in perfect order the very tips of His finger. And I believe at that time many people wondered, why did God choose this part of the body to prove His ability to return us back perfectly? Why didn't He choose something more sophisticated, more complicated, like the blood circle or anything like that? And now people discover that this part of your body has its unique fingerprint. God says, we will turn you back perfectly, even with the same fingerprint. To be a Muslim, I have to believe in all the messengers of God. We believe that there's only one God. And there's only one humankind, because there's no difference between us. Men are not better than women, whites are not better than blacks, Arabs are not better than Indians. So if there is only one God and only one humankind, this means that there is only one sender and only one recipient. If there is only one sender and only one recipient, why would anyone sane think that the same sender will send to the same recipient different messages, contradicting messages, to confuse them? Of course not. It has to be the same message. So we believe that there were never religions with an S. It was always one religion. Not the religion of Muhammad, but the religion of God. Allah in Arabic, Allah in Hebrew, which exists in the Quran twice. God with a capital G in English, Dieu in French, God in German. The sender, God sent the same message through ages to the same humankind, but with different messengers. So, one religion, one God, one humankind, many messengers and many books of the same religion. And this religion has to be suitable for everyone. What is suitable for everyone? People ask you before you drink coffee, maybe you don't drink coffee. People ask you before you drink tea, because maybe you don't drink tea, what is the only thing that is given to you always without asking you? It's water. Why? Did anyone ever ask you, do you drink water? Why are you laughing? It's a funny question, huh? It's just a liquid, no? Like tea, no, it's not like tea. No one will ever ask you if you drink water or what, because water has no color. It doesn't smell anything. It tastes good to all, for all people, because it's neither salty nor sweet. the religion of God that should be suitable for all mankind should be as pure as water. Should not be limited. So to be a Muslim, I have to believe one message that all messengers came with, and it is worship God alone and do not associate any partner with him. Muslims believe that all messengers are the best of human beings and they do not commit major sins. Because if we believe that messengers commit major sins, then it is against the... It's like we're attacking God himself. It's like God cannot choose better people or more respectable to be his messengers. So when God chose, he knew how to choose. We believe that none of them is divine, which means that none of them is the Son of God. We also believe that Jesus is a messenger like other messengers. But we believe that Jesus is one of the best 5 messengers who ever walked the face of the earth. One of the mightiest 5. And his mother, Mary, is looked at in Islam like the, according to the Quran, as the purest woman who ever walked the face of the earth. We have a chapter in the Quran called Mary. We don't have a chapter called named after the mother of Prophet Muhammad or after any of his daughters or wives or anyone. Mary. By the way, Jesus was mentioned 25 times in the Quran. Prophet Muhammad was mentioned 4 times in the Quran. So I cannot be a Muslim if I don't have the love of Jesus and Mary in my heart, by the way. I know that this sounds nice, but maybe this guy presenting this presentation to us is a liar. He's trying to beautify his religion, but when Muslims turn their back to us, they only believe in Muhammad. No, I said the Quran is the principal source for every Muslim's faith and practice. Look what the Quran tells us. Say, we believe in Allah. And the revelation given to us, which is the Quran, and the revelation given to Abraham, Ishmael, Isaac, Jacob, and the tribes, and the revelation given to Moses and Jesus, and the revelation given to all the prophets from their Lord, we make no difference between one and another of them. And we submit to Allah, which means, and we are Muslims. I cannot be a Muslim if I exclude Jacob. I'm not Muslim. If I believe in God and all the tenets of Islam and all the messengers of Islam, but I exclude Jacob or Ishmael or Abraham or Jesus or Muhammad, I'm not Muslim. We don't pick and choose. There's a God who sent us a message. We have to take it all. Of course, Prophet Muhammad is an important figure in Islam. Many of you came here thinking that Prophet Muhammad is the founder of Islam. I prove to you now, he is merely the last and final messenger of Islam. Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, is a colleague of Jesus and Moses and Abraham and Noah, a graduate of the same school from which they graduated, the school of God. His traditions are called the Sunnah, which are the number 2 source for knowledge and legislation after the Quran in Islam. And his people used to call him the trustworthy and the truthful. His people, I mean, before Islam, pagans used to love him so much, trust him so much, they called him the trustworthy and the truthful. But when he said, there is no God except Allah, you have to leave the worship of idols, you have to be nicer to women, you have to free the slaves, you have to, you have to, you have to, they opposed him. They opposed him and they tried to kill him. They tried to stop him by all means. They tried to assassinate him. They tried to kill him and they killed some of his followers. It is worthy mentioning that the very first martyr in Islam was a woman, not a man. Lady Sumayya, an Islamophobe, jabbed her with a spear in her private parts. That's the first martyr in Islam. And they tortured him and his followers. They negotiated with him. And they said, what do you need? Money? We can make you the most wealthy, but please stop preaching what you're preaching. Women, we will marry you from the most beautiful of women, but please stop preaching this message. Authority, we will make you the king of Arabia, but please stop. And he said, if they put the sun in my right hand and the moon in my left hand to quit, I won't stop conveying this message till it is conveyed or I die conveying it. And he refused to compromise his freedom of speech. Prophet Muhammad is the most beautiful example because he was not just a prophet. He was also a merchant. So he was an example for every trader, for every businessman. He was also a father. So he was an example for every father. A husband, an example for every husband. A teacher, a politician, a negotiator, and a warrior. Prophet Muhammad was a warrior. He fought. But he taught Muslims how to fight. There's another presentation that I can give to you next time. It's called Jihad. War on terrorism. Because many people are troubled when they hear the word jihad, thinking that it means terrorism. And then you see that Muslims are using the word to name their children. You can find a three-year-old girl with rosy cheeks, blonde hair, and you ask her, what's your name, honey? Tell me, my name is Jihad. So, for some people, it's very scary. For some people, it's like the most, it's a very beautiful term. Someone must have some misunderstanding then. So actually, the word jihad doesn't mean terrorism. It means war on terrorism. But that's a separate presentation that you can watch on YouTube, or I can come here next time to give it to you. It's a long one. Prophet Muhammad gave hope to billions of people. One of his traditions that always have inspired me is this one. He said, if you are planting a tree and the end of the world came suddenly, just go ahead and plant it quickly. Some people, they say that this doesn't make sense. Why would I plant a tree at the end of the world? It's not only that I'm not going to eat from it. There is no coming generations to eat from it. It doesn't make sense. No. It explains the system in Islam. In Islam, this means that on the day of judgment, God will not ask you for the results, but rather for the effort. Here in this life, you are asked by your boss for the results. He tells you, show me the numbers, show me the sales, show me your production. God doesn't care about your numbers, about your sales, or about your production. God cares about your effort. Did you do effort or not? And that's why sometimes we do effort, and then when it's not fruitful and we don't get rewarded, we believe that life is unfair. Because you are not rewarded according to the effort, but to the results. Many non-Muslim philosophers and thinkers were fair towards Prophet Muhammad when they read his biography objectively, like Lamartine. Lamartine is actually a famous French historian who authored the book L'Histoire de la Turquie, which means the history of the Turks. He said about Prophet Muhammad, if greatness of purpose, smallness of means, and outstanding results are the three criteria of human genius, who could dare to compare any great man in modern history with Muhammad? That's not a Muslim who said that. Mahatma Gandhi. Let's see what this man of peace said about Prophet Muhammad. He said, I became more than convinced that it was not the sword that won a place for Islam in those days in the scheme of life. It was the rigid simplicity, the utter self-effacement of the Prophet, the scrupulous regard for his pledges, his intense devotion to his friends and followers, his intrepidity, his fearlessness, his absolute trust in God and in his own mission. And Wolfgang Goethe, the most famous European poet, he said, he is a prophet and not a poet, and therefore his Quran is to be seen as a divine law, not as a book of a human being made for education or entertainment. To be a Muslim, I have to believe in the day of judgment. Muslims believe that death is not an end. Death is a beginning for a new life. It's like a gate from which you go to a different place. And we believe that when people die, they will be resurrected again, and God will ask them about what they did in this life. Otherwise, then God cannot be just. Because there are people who committed crimes, killed millions of people. Just a few days ago, that was the memorial of the Holocaust. And those people were not punished in this life. Do you think they will go get away with their crimes like that? And God cannot be just then. And there are people who are nice and kind and no one honored them in this life. Do you think they will go away like that without coming back and be honored and rewarded? Then God cannot be just like that. So to be a Muslim, one has to believe in the judgment day, that there is resurrection after death. We will be reading our books of deeds. We will be held accountable for everything we did. It will be a fair trial judgment, and those who will not be forgiven by God will be punished, and those who will be forgiven by God will be rewarded. And this will be an eternal life. So the true life is there. This life is, we call it the lowly worldly life. It's lowly, but it's important. Because whatever you plant here is what you reap there. To be a Muslim, one has to believe in the sixth belief, the last belief today, but it is a very important one. In my own opinion, one of the most important beliefs, because through this, you can avoid depression. It is to believe in the divine destiny. We believe that nothing happens without the knowledge of God, and that by His knowledge, He prescribed everything that is happening. If He knows, then why worry? The good and the bad. He knows. Actually, how do you know that if something good happens, that it's really good? Or if something bad is really bad? Didn't it happen to you before that something good happened and you became so excited and happy? After a while, you discover that, oh, that's the worst thing that ever happened to me in my life. And didn't it happen before that something bad could have happened and you became so miserable and sad, and then after a while you discover that, wow, that's the best thing that happened to me in my life. Right? So if you don't really know what is really good and what is really bad, why are we still exaggerating in our feelings of happiness or the feeling of sadness? To believe in the divine destiny is to exchange the feelings of sadness and happiness with the feeling of acceptance, contentment. Something good happens, accept. Don't be too excited, maybe it's not good. Something bad happens, accept. This is more stable than happiness or sadness. I want to tell you something. What they did not say in the beginning when they introduced me is that I'm a survivor of 9/11. By the way, I'm an electronics engineer. I'm not an E-man. But since 9/11, I'm only doing what I'm doing right now. Why? Because on 9/11, I was in Manhattan, New York. And with two other people, we were stopping a taxi at 8 o'clock in the morning to go to the World Trade Center. No taxi stopped for half an hour. Imagine how people look like when they're trying to stop a taxi for 10 minutes. Very frustrated. Half an hour. Imagine how we looked like. We were so disappointed. And God was saving our lives. Since then, I am never happy. I am never sad. I just accept. I don't know. To be a Muslim, one has to do five main things. Yes. Short break? Okay, do you want to take a short break? We have like 15 minutes of that. Want to take a short break first? No? We are in a democracy. Those who want a break, raise your hands. Minority.
Thank you, thank you. I'm Egyptian, but I'm pro-democracy, not pro-coup. I'm one of the Egyptians who are anti-Sisi, by the way. To be a Muslim, one has to do 5 main deeds. One, to declare his faith through the inseparable testimony. Second, and the inseparable testimony is to say, there is no deity worthy of worship except Allah. Muhammad is a messenger of Allah. Hey, why only Muhammad? You just told us. You believe in all the messengers. Muhammad and Moses and Jesus and Abraham and Noah. Why now only Muhammad? We will come to this in details. One has to establish the prayer. One has to pay a financial obligation called the zakah. How much? And to whom? We will come to this in details. One has to fast the month of Ramadan. And one has to do pilgrimage to Mecca. With the inseparable testimony. Everything in this life has a key. The key to enter Islam is this inseparable testimony. When I came to this country, I applied for a visa. And in the visa application, I signed that I will not be carrying any forbidden goods to this country. Same thing. When someone wants to come to Islam, he has to declare that he is not carrying any forbidden beliefs. It is to say, I bear witness that there is no deity worthy of worship except God, Allah in Arabic, Allah in Hebrew. That's my quote. Oh, yeah. God, which is Allah in Arabic, Allah in Hebrew, God in the capital G in English, Dieu in French, doesn't matter. So I have to bear witness that there is only one God and that Muhammad is a messenger of God. Yeah, why only Muhammad is mentioned now? Because we believe that there is no God except one God, unity, oneness of God. We believe in the oneness of humankind and in the unity of the concept of prophethood. If you believe in the last prophet, then you are acknowledging those who came before him. Saying that there is no God except Allah and Muhammad is a messenger of God is an acknowledgement of Muhammad and Moses and Jesus and Noah and so on. At the time of Jesus, we believe it was like that. There is no God except Allah, the Hebrew name, and Jesus is the messenger of God. At the time of Moses it was, and Moses is the messenger of God, acknowledging Moses and those before him and so on. Whoever says this with sincerity is to be considered a Muslim, and whoever dies on this belief will enter paradise if his sins are forgiven, because Islam is the only religion, maybe, that guarantees punishment for his followers if they don't do the good work. The concept of salvation in Islam is a bird that flies with two wings. With one wing, it will fall down. If you believe, that's not enough. You have to believe and do good deeds. That's why you will always find believing and doing good deeds associated with each other in the Quran. The testimony is actually a liberation, because actually we live in prisons. The fear from poverty is a prison that many of us are living in it. Fear of a tyrant is a prison. Fear from the future is a prison. When you say there is no God except the one true God, it breaks your chains. It means that I do not fear except Allah. I do not hope except from Allah. I do not complain except to Allah. I do not love except Allah and what Allah loves. Good. I do not dislike except what Allah dislikes, which is evil, and so on. So like that, this testimony becomes the core of one's faith, and it liberates him and doesn't make him worry at all about the future or poverty or anything like that. Because he knows that there is one who will take care of him all the time. To be a Muslim,
one has to establish the prayers. There are five obligatory prayers that number one should be done on time. The first one is at dawn. The second one is at noon. The third one is in the afternoon. The fourth, which should be the five, that's the sunset. And there is one in the evening that should be done on time, and that can be done on any pure spot on earth. The best way is to do it in congregation. Brothers and sisters in the mosque at the best. I'm too lazy to go to the mosque every time. I can pray in congregation with my family at home, or with my colleagues in our office. If I don't find anyone to pray with me, I can pray individually. Anywhere, in the airport. And get the light boarding after that. That was a joke, but it happened to me actually. Muslims always turn their faces towards one direction, all towards Mecca. So you will never come here to this mosque and find us praying to that direction. No, always towards this direction. Where actually a black cubical building exists called the Kaaba. So we turn our faces towards this building in Mecca called the Kaaba. The Kaaba is not an idol that Muslims worship. Muslims believe that the Kaaba cannot do any good or any harm for anyone. It is merely the first house of worship ever built on earth. And now we turn our faces towards it because like that it unites us around it in worshiping circles. You see the circles? Those circles keep widening, widening, widening until they spread all over the earth. So here when you saw us praying in this mosque, in four straight lines, they were not straight lines. Those were four sectors of four big circles around the Kaaba. So when I stand alone, individually praying, I am not alone. I speak in a plural tense, even though I'm praying individually, and I say, you alone we worship, and to you alone we turn for help. I don't say I worship or I turn for help. There's no one next to me. No, there is someone on the circle, maybe in Denmark, maybe in China, maybe on a boat, maybe on a mountain. The Kaaba gives us the sense of universality of the religion. But it's not an idol that we worship, and we believe it cannot do any harm or any good for anyone. We believe that all biblical prophets prayed as you see Muslims praying today. Have you seen us when we fall on the ground with our faces on the floor? If you open Matthew 26:39, it tells you, and he, Jesus, went a little further and fell on his face and prayed. And of course, the Old Testament is full of that. Aaron and Moses and Abraham and Noah, all of them fell on their faces, beseeching their Lord. What do we do on our faces? We put our nose and our forehead on the ground. Those are the signs of dignity, yes. We humble ourselves to the Almighty. The one who humbles himself to the Almighty like that and doesn't grow arrogant against the Almighty will increase him in honor. But I should not grow arrogant against the Almighty. To be a Muslim, I have to pay a financial obligation. How much? And to whom? Muslims who have a saving for more than a significant saving, like over £3,000 or something, held for a whole year without being touched, which means it is excess money. They have to spend 2.5% of this cash saving, which is £25 for every 1,000. To whom? Not to Al-Qaeda, not to ISIS, but rather to the poor and to the needy and to the hungry people and to the homeless. We believe that it's a shame when there are people who have money and people who are homeless. If all rich people can spend those 2.5% of their savings every year, there would be no homeless. 5 to 10% of any agricultural income, 5% for those who have an irrigation system, because there are costs coming out of their pocket for irrigation. 10% in countries that depend on rain, like for Malaysia, for example. I've been to Malaysia,
Three times?
Every single day it's raining there. They don't have irrigation system. So 10% should be spent on the agriculture income. 20% of any extracted resources or minerals, like petroleum, which means that countries should spend 20% of their income from extracted resources on the poor, the needy, the hungry people, and the homeless before they buy weapons for their armies. And we believe that this zakah is not a charity. It is the right of the poor on the rich. Charity is what Muslims spend extra to this. But this is not a charity, it's the right of the poor on the rich. And guess what? The word zakah in Arabic language means growth and purification. Can you imagine this? The ritual in which I spend is called growing. Growing what? It's by purifying my money from the rights of others, it grows. It is something that we know and we see by experience. Those who are stingy, they don't spend their zakah, we see some of their businesses declining. And those who are generous and they give to the poor, God protects their businesses and it grows. It's something that I cannot prove to you, but it's by experience. And ask Muslims about that. To be a Muslim, one has to fast the month of Ramadan. Ramadan is the ninth month in the lunar calendar. And in Ramadan, Muslims do not eat or drink or have any sexual activity with their spouses, of course, from dawn until sunset. So at dawn, one controls himself from doing the lawful, eating, drinking, and having sex. By sunset, he or she can practice any of that again. Next day, control, practice, control, practice, control that for 30 days. You see what I'm doing? Looks like a workout, an exercise. After 30 days, I become behind the wheel, driving my body, not my body, driving me. I become in control of my stomach and my lower self, not controlled by my stomach and my lower self. So we can say that fasting, the month of Ramadan, is a ritual of worship that enhances patience and perseverance through the discipline. You discipline your own self to become in control of your desires. God Almighty said about fasting, O you who believe, fasting has been prescribed upon you like it was prescribed upon those before you, that you may guard yourselves. You protect yourself from your own desires. Because desires, Islamically, if not controlled and enjoyed within the frame that God gave to us, it will corrupt the human being. It will destroy the human being. To be a Muslim, one has to do pilgrimage to Mecca. Pilgrimage is only once in a lifetime as an obligation. I made pilgrimage 6 times. The first one is the obligation. The next 5 times were extra. Every Muslim who is able financially or and physically should do a pilgrimage to Mecca. And there, we see the universality of the religion. No one knows there if this pilgrim who wears the very simple clothes is rich or poor. Maybe he's poor, but someone donated for him the ticket to go and do pilgrimage. And maybe this one is not poor, and he is an owner of a chain of hotels in his country. For a few days, we are all the same, wearing simple clothes. There's no difference between us, moving from one place to the other together, worshiping together, eating together. And this changed the life of so many. It changed my own life. And it changed the life of someone very famous and Muslims love, called Malcolm X. Malcolm X, for those who don't know him, is one of the leaders of the black nationalistic liberation movement in the 60s in the United States of America. He was from a group of people who had racist views against whites. Maybe because of all what the black people went through in this country, but still, if you become a Muslim, you cannot be racist. When this man went to Hajj or pilgrimage, he changed. And he sent these beautiful words in a letter that he sent back to New York announcing the change. He said, during the past 11 days here in the Muslim world, I have eaten from the same plate and drank from the same glass and slept on the same carpet with fellow Muslims whom their skin is the whitest of white. Their eyes are the bluest of blue. Their hair is the blondest of blonde. And in their deeds and in their worship, I felt the same sincerity of the black people from Sudan or Ghana or Nigeria. And he came back to the States and he joined mainstream Islam. With that, we finished the meaning of the word Islam, the six main beliefs and the five deeds. When I discuss anything about women, I have a very short presentation for 10 minutes about women if you want. If not, we will open the floor for questions and answers. Who wants the presentation about women? Raise your hands. That's half and half. Okay. Who thinks that there will be questions about women in the questions and answers? So let's do the presentation. Believe me, this will save you the questions. I know that when you see Muslim women wearing hijab, you ask yourself sometimes, why are they wearing like that? But you know who is she? Mary. Actually, Christians believe this is the picture of Virgin Mary. And this is Mother Teresa. Mary, in the eyes of Christians and Muslims, is the purest woman who ever walked the face of the earth, right? Mother Teresa, all of us respect her so much, one of the very pious and righteous women who helped the poor a lot all over the world through her organizations. So we can say that those two women are maybe the best two women in your eyes, Mary and Mother Teresa. That's my daughter. What is common in the three of them?
There's a difference between the third one and the first one.
Yeah, it's hijab. So all of them are totally covered except the faces and hands. So actually, when sometimes you see a Muslim woman and you wonder, why is she wearing like that? Sometimes she has the same question about you, by the way. If the best women in your eyes are wearing like that, why aren't you wearing also like that? I'm not trying to tell you to wear hijab at all. I'm just telling you, sometimes we have questions about people who have the same question about us. Let's stop stereotyping each other and come together and ask and speak in a friendly atmosphere. We will not come out of this room, all of us, with the same opinions. No. We are different and we have to be different, and difference is good. In one hand, you cannot have two similar fingers. And that's what gives it strength. Let's not just hate each other or stereotype each other. Let's come together and have a chat. Actually, why Muslim women are wearing like that? It's a verse in the Quran that says, and say to the believing men, he didn't say women here, that they should lower their gaze, which means not to stare at the... To lower the gaze is not to stare at the officers. For me, take off your glasses. That they should lower their gaze and cover their private parts. That is purer for them, and Allah is aware of all that they do. The next verse, and say to the believing women, that they should lower their gaze and cover their private parts, that they should not display their beauty except that which is apparent, and to draw their veils, so there are veils, head coverings, over their bosoms. So Muslim women, according to the Quran, should wear like that and cover their head. And not to reveal their beauty except to their husbands, their fathers, their husbands' fathers, their sons, their husbands' sons, their brothers' sons, or the sisters' sons, which means all close relatives that cannot marry her. She can show her hair and her arms to them like she's normal at home. Okay? Because they cannot marry her or think of her as a future wife or in any sexual way. Actually, this means that Muslim women are not all the time covering themselves like that. Only when they are around as citizens, but not when they are around as wives, not when they are around as close relatives. Which means they are told to neutralize the sexual dimension when they are around the citizens, so that people can deal with them seriously, without judging them according to their appearance, to their body, to their beauty, to deal with her as a mind and not as anything else. All men and women in Islam are equal before God. Equal. All men and women in Islam are equal before the law. Even the Islamic law. Equal. All men and women in Islam are subject to be equally rewarded or equally punished by God and by the law. In Islam, women are like men. They have the right to seek education, or they have the obligation to seek education. There is a saying of Prophet Muhammad that seeking knowledge is an obligation on every Muslim man and woman. They have the right to engage in business. They have the right to engage in professions. They have the right to engage in public life, and they have the right to keep their family name. When I get married, my wife doesn't take my family name. She keeps her name and her identity. The possessions of women are secured. Actually, if a woman decides to share the household expenses with her husband and help, that's a charity from her according to Islam. She will be rewarded by God as if she is spending in charity, and her husband has to show a lot of appreciation for her for doing that. And by the way, women had a big role in the Egyptian revolution against Mubarak and against Sisi and against the coup. They were always there in the front lines. In our peaceful protests, they were always there. And they were victims. They were victimized by both regimes. To conclude, if any society or individual oppresses women or discriminates against them, it is against Islam, not because of it. Thank you. Like that, we finish today. We will open the floor now. This is live on Facebook, by the way. Okay, so if you want to open the floor, we can have questions.